We're going to praise the Lord now and forever. Begin to worship the Lord. You can be seated for just a moment. We're going to continue to worship the Lord. I'm going to read a fairly long passage, but I want to read this about Jesus Christ and Him and His seat and His authority in heaven now. John says, "And I saw in the right hand of Him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals, and I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?' And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders said unto me, 'Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof.' And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb, as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth." And the Lord Jesus is worthy. Amen. The Lord Jesus is worthy. There wasn't a man in heaven, in earth, or under the earth that was worthy to open that book, but Jesus is. And He was. He's prevailed. He prevailed on the cross over death and hell and sin and the grave, and He is seated in authority in heaven right now. He's here with us in this place to meet with us. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Thank you, Father. Father, we bless You this morning. Oh God, we thank You for Your kindness to us. God, we thank You for Your power. Lord, You're worthy. And we just lift our hands to You this morning. We acknowledge that You're worthy. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. God, fill this place with Your Holy Spirit. Be lifted up and magnified, that every eye would see Jesus by faith, high and lifted up. We love You today, God, and we worship You, Lord. Receive these songs from our lips, God, as praise and adoration unto You. In Jesus' name we pray.
Is the glory of Is he worthy? Is he worthy? new heaven and a new earth, where the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. There was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them, and be their God.
And God shall wipe away all the tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away."
And I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof.
And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it, and the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor into it, and the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it, and there shall in no wise enter into it anything that defileth, either whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. And God, I pray, God, as we just meditate on these words, Lord, I pray as your people, God, that we keep our eyes on eternity. God, our nation is greatly troubled, and Lord, I pray that they would turn to you. I pray we as a church would point them to you, God. Lord, help us to keep our eternity, God. That's the most important thing is sharing this gospel, Lord. Pray, help us to live, not only to speak it, but to live it, Lord. And God, I just pray, speak to us. I pray with events, the recent events, Lord, I pray people would turn to you, God. And I pray that you keep us as a church, help us to keep our eyes on you, Father. In Jesus' name.
The race is long. Sometimes I stumble. He helps me up each time I hope. He gives me courage, so I'll press on and give my all. And I know I never have to run alone, and I can hardly wait to make it. In every joy, We thank you, Lord, that the best is still ahead of us, Lord God. All that we have in Christ Jesus, Lord. Everything in this earth is going to pass away. You said, but he that does the will of God abides forever. Lord, we bless you and thank you, Lord God, that you saved us into such a wonderful living hope that you have for our lives, God. We worship you this morning. We thank you, Lord God, that our sins have been washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ, that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, God. We thank you that this world is not our home. We have a home prepared for us, God. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, for putting that knowing in our hearts now, to trust you and believe you for what's to come. We bless you and thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. I haven't sung that song in a long time, and I was pretty sure I wasn't going to get through it. That part, that phrase, or that line in the song about when earthly treasures cloud my point of view, it reminds me that I'm only passing through. We need to be reminded of that.
Amen.
We're just passing through. This is not our home. Heaven is our home. And we're here to tell people about the Lord and to glorify God until we get there. And I just am very thankful for that. I want you, if you would, turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 3. We've been doing a series. This is the fourth and the last part of this series on Sunday mornings on three important doctrines in the Bible. All the doctrines in the Bible are important, but three important doctrines: justification, sanctification, and today, hallelujah, glorification. And we spent the last 2 weeks on sanctification. If you have not heard these sermons, I would encourage you just to go. You can pull them up on our website and listen to them, or look at them on the YouTube channel. They kind of build upon each other. But I want you, if you would, to turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1. We're going to start reading in verse 3. We have a lot of scriptures we're going to read today. I would encourage you to, at the very least, jot down the scriptures, these passages. We have probably more scriptures today than any of the other parts of this series. But read with me, starting in verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again to a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen ye love, and whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. As Christians, you could say, and it is not incorrect to say this, that we were saved the day you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. You can write that down just like your birthday. Okay, you were saved on such and such a day, and you passed from death to life, and you were born again, you were washed in the blood of Jesus and justified. But we are also being saved. It's not incorrect to say that the Lord is keeping us presently, and through this life, he's preserving us and saving us and keeping us. Thank God he does, amen?
Amen.
And we will be saved. There is a future. What do I mean? What we say, I'm already saying. In a future tense, there's a completion to our salvation. There is more to our salvation than what we have yet experienced that is coming, that's sure, and is set there for us and reserved for us. And so this is what we're talking about today. I guess you could say that part of our salvation. You were saved on such and such a day. We're all being saved and preserved by the goodness of God. He keeps us in the midst of this ungodly world and keeps us his all through this life. And we will be saved in the sense of a completion to our salvation. all those that are in Christ, and that's the key, is we're in Christ or not in Christ. Not in church, but in Christ. Okay? That's what's important. There are people that are in churches all over our country that are not, may not be in Christ. And there are people in Christian homes and families that that individual may not be in Christ. But once we're saved, we're in Christ, and we are justified. Therefore, being justified, past tense, by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm reviewing. This was part one of this series. All right? We have been justified by the Lord Jesus Christ. Being justified, Romans 3:24 says, freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. And as being such, in Romans 8 says, there is therefore now, right now, no condemnation to them that are who? Where? In Christ Jesus. That's us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. That is our salvation. That is a justification. That is where we're robed in the righteousness of another, Christ the Lord. Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. God does the same for us. All of us who are in Christ and who are justified and saved, if we die, we're going to heaven, we are currently being sanctified. We're being sanctified. Take back my brother David. I remember when I first met him, where God's brought him from to where he is now. Where God's brought me from where I was when I first surrendered to the Lord to where I am now. I can look at you and see the work of sanctification in your life, where the Bible, the Lord says, as he which is holy and called you is holy, so be ye holy. How? In all manner of conversation. This is the will of God, even your sanctification. In practical, everyday life, being holy. More like God, more like Jesus. He's working it in our lives. But it is a real work, so we are being sanctified. He's the potter, we're the clay. Okay, he's working on us. And we're more like Jesus now than we were the day we got saved. Hallelujah. And if he tarries another 5-10 years, we're going to be more like the Lord. Until then, for God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto sanctification, okay, unto holiness. All will one day, so we were justified in Christ. All those in Christ are currently being sanctified. Our standing is still in Christ, but our Christ-likeness is increasing. More fruit, okay, more godliness. Thank the Lord for that. He didn't just leave us in the same state. He saves us and begins to work in our lives in a real way and makes us more like the Lord. But all those that are saved and being sanctified will one day, future, be glorified. Will be glorified. Praise the Lord. With the Lord and by the Lord. So I want to go back over to the passage we read. We started in verse 3, and I just want you to, I'm going to point out some phrases or key words where it says, blessed is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It says, which has begotten us, or hath begotten us. So that means we're already saved, we're already begotten, we're already born of the Lord. You don't have to be born again. We're born again. Blessed be God for who has begotten us. Okay, that's the new birth. But then he says, unto the end of verse 3, a living hope. There's a living hope. There's a hope that is set before us. And then he says, to an inheritance, verse 4, incorruptible. So where is that? Where is that inheritance? And when is that inheritance? Well, it's before us. It's in front of us. We have not fully received this inheritance yet. I'm not saying we're not saved. I'm not saying we don't have so many blessings in Christ. But there is an inheritance that is set before us. Where is it? It's reserved in heaven for you. Reserved in heaven for you. Who are kept by the power of God through faith. Who are kept, that means currently, right now, believers are being kept by the power of the Lord. Kept here is a military term. It means a garrison. It means a guard. It means to defend. It means to keep. We are currently being kept by the Lord, by the power of God, through faith. So the Lord keeps us, and we keep our faith in the Lord. That's how he keeps us. We don't abandon the faith. We don't walk away from the faith. The Lord keeps us. Now unto him, Jude says, who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before his throne of the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Unto the only wise God be glory. Amen? Amen. It's unto him who's able to keep us from falling through faith, his mercy, his power, and our faith in the Lord, ready to be revealed in the last time. The end of verse 5. Ready to be revealed. See, that's future, right? Amen. The whole purpose of this series was to not... there seems to be a lot of confusion in our day between justification, sanctification, glorification, where we are now. You know, we're not fully sanctified. We're being sanctified, but I am fully justified. I'm saved, and I one day will be glorified. It's important that we get these doctrines. They're all from the Lord. They're all by the grace of God. They come to us all by faith, and they're all through Christ, and yet they're not all the same thing. If we can get confused in thinking that we're already in the millennial reign of Christ and in a glorified state, we're not. We're not. We can get confused thinking the day I got saved, I was perfectly and completely sanctified in all manner of conversation. You were not. We are being sanctified, and we one day will be glorified. Ready to be revealed the last time. He says, now in this life, may be for a season we go through trials and manifold temptations, that the trial of our faith may one day be found to the glory of God. When? At his, the end of verse 7, at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Verse 8, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your soul. I thought I was already saved. You are, if you've trusted Christ, and so am I, all those that have trusted Christ. But there is an end of our salvation, in the sense there is a completion. Not that it's going to cease to be, but it's going to be completed. It's going to be fulfilled. When it says receiving the end of your faith, the word, Greek word there is telos. It's the same word that Jesus used on the cross when he said it is finished. He fulfilled all the scriptures, all the prophecies. He took all the sins of the world upon him. Everything was done according to the scriptures and the word of God. It was all placed upon him and finished in him. And he says, it is finished. It's telos. It's ended. It's completed. He said on the cross, and he gave up the ghost and he died. So the word, the end of your faith, even the salvation of your soul, that word for end means completion. It means finally. It means to the uttermost. It means the end of a thing. It's completed. It's finished. I want to read this. I'm just going to read this passage for time's sake. 1 Corinthians 13, this chapter on love, right? Love is patient. Love is kind. Well, it brings to the end of the chapter. It says, For we know in part, right now, Paul said, now, we know how much? In part. We know in part. Much as you know the Lord and not know the Lord, and we're getting to know him more every day, we still only know in part, right? We still only know in part. Now we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, I believe that's the return of the Lord or his appearing, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly. When do we see through a glass darkly? Now. When we're still on this planet, as saved people on this earth, and we're living, and we're not walking around in the streets of gold right now, okay? We will one day. That is our inheritance. But it says, now we see through a glass darkly. It's like almost like an opaque glass where you can see through it, but you can't see it all, everything distinctly and perfectly. I know it's there. I see light shining through. You can see some shape or some figure, but I don't see it fully. It's like it's blurry, okay? Now we see through a glass darkly, but then, that's to come, face to face, just like this. For now, I know in part, but then shall I know, even as also I am known. There is coming a day. There's a completion to our salvation. an end of our salvation, a fulfilling of all things, where we're going to see the Lord face to face, where faith will end in sight. Faith will end in sight. We'll see the Lord, we'll be with the Lord, and all that's unknown will be known. It's the best way I can put it. I want you to turn with me to Romans chapter 8. We're going to look at a lot of scriptures. Jot this one down if you are taking notes. Romans chapter 8, we're going to read quite a bit starting in verse 16. So what is this glorification that we're focusing on today? It's ahead of us, okay? It's ahead of us. Romans 8, we're going to read 16 through 19 and then we'll skip down. Romans 8, 16 says, "The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God." So we're saved. If we're saved, we're saved. The Holy Ghost bears witness that we belong to the Lord. "And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together." That's a key word. We may be glorified together. "If I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed," where? In us. There's a glory that's going to be revealed in us. "For the earnest expectation of the creature," that would be all the creation, including mankind, "waited for the manifestation of the sons of God." Verse 21, "Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body." That's a key verse for our message today. The redemption of our body is something we're waiting for, the redemption of our bodies. That means it hasn't taken place yet. "For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it." So there's something coming that we wait for. As Christians, justified in Christ, forgiven, robed in the righteousness of Christ, being sanctified by the Lord all the days of our Christian life on this earth, and yet there's something ahead of us still, okay, that we're waiting for. And we do with patience wait for it. Paul was saying, "I'm waiting for it." We're waiting for it. Specifically, it is a glorification together with the Lord, okay? It includes, and a big part of it is the glorified bodies that we will receive. Glorified bodies. These bodies are not fit for heaven. These bodies are not fit for eternity. These bodies are fit for this earth, and they're part of corruption. They decay, they fall apart. That inward man is being renewed day by day, but the outward man, the Bible says, is perishing. Okay? The outward man, but one day that outward man is going to be redeemed. That body is going to be glorified. So I want to talk about a few words. At the end of verse 17, when he says, "that we may be also glorified together." What does it mean, glorified? Because we're talking about, this is the sermon today, glorification. What does it mean to be glorified? The word means to exalt to dignity. It means to esteem or render glorious, to full honor, to magnify. To magnify, to exalt to dignity. One day we don't look like that much. I mean, you're all good-looking people, but you understand, we don't look like that much on this earth. We're not that much different physically in our looks from other people, okay? And yet, there's Christ in us, the hope of glory, and there's something coming. There's something coming where we are going to be, and all we can say is hallelujah. All we can say is thank you, Lord, that we're going to be glorified to full dignity, and we don't exalt ourselves. The Lord will glorify us. The Bible teaches against, even on this earth, to exalt and magnify ourselves. We don't do that. The Lord gives the promotion. The Lord gives the honor. The Lord promotes and exalts. I think about Daniel in Babylon. He didn't seek to exalt himself, and yet he served God. He was exalted to prime minister. I think about Joseph in the same thing in Egypt. He didn't exalt himself, yet he was taken from prison and made prime minister of Egypt. Their promotion comes from the Lord. Amen. It comes from the Lord, and the Lord exalts us. And so Jesus was the same way. Where he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death on the cross, wherefore God has highly exalted him. So we are going to be exalted to full dignity, full honor. We are going to be magnified. But I think it's very telling, there's another part of this definition. Besides being magnified or exalted, it means similarly, it means with. It means to glorify together. It means a union, a companionship, a resemblance to. So think about it. It's not just some glory that the Lord waves a magic wand and we're kind of separate from him and he puts a little glory on us. What he's going to do, he's going to glorify us together with himself. The same, whatever the glory of God is, which is the perfect glory, we are going to be partakers of that. We're glorified together. That's what it says at the end of verse 17. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. We're going to be glorified together with him. And so we're not glorified independently from the Lord, I guess is my point. We're glorified together in the Lord. By the Lord, with the Lord. It comes from him. And so our Lord has chosen, and it's just the kindness of the Lord, to share his glory with us. Jesus and the Father share this glory, and he has chosen for us as believers that have put our trust in him to be partakers of that as well. I don't fully understand it. I know it has to do with the glory, our glorified bodies as well, but it's going to be a Christ-likeness. It's going to be a resemblance, not just exalted like a king of a country, but exalted with the Christ-likeness and the glory of the Lord. Just real quickly, turn to John 17. So here's Jesus. He's praying. This is the night he's going to be arrested. The next day he'll be crucified. He's with his disciples. Praying to his Father, they hear him, he's praying for them. Look at John chapter 17, let's read verses 4 through 6. So he's praying to his Father, I have glorified thee on the earth. He's praying to his Father, I have finished the work thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thy own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. There is some measure of glory Jesus laid aside when he took on human flesh. He's still God. Never ceased to be God, but a measure of glory that he possessed in heaven, that he has again now, that he didn't have when he was on the earth. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. Let's skip down to verse 10. And all are mine. And all mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified where? In them. Verse 22. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Verse 24. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. There is a glory, but not just a glory, it's specifically the glory of God. It's the glory of Christ. It's the glory that the Father and the Son share together. And he has prayed, Lord, Father, I want them to be glorified and share in the same glory. And we do. We're partakers of his divine nature. Our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, but there is a completion to it that is still to come. Amen? It is still to come. I think about this scripture, and we've talked about it several times in this series, where John says in 1 John chapter 3, "Beloved, now are we the sons of God." When? Right now. Are you born again? You're a son of God. Now are we the sons of God. And it does not yet, right now, appear what we shall be. So what is that future? Right now I'm a son of the living God, but it has not fully appeared or manifest what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, that's a key, when he shall appear, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. The change is going to be when we see him. The likeness is going to be not like a Superman or like this or like that or a beautiful sunset. The change is going to be like Christ. We're glorified. When we see him, we will be like him. When he shall appear, it says, we shall see him as he is. That is what we're speaking of. We're going to see the Lord, not even like the disciples saw him on this earth. They got to see him physically, but they didn't get to see him in the state that he is now, in the glorified state that he is now, in the glory that he had before he came to the earth. We're going to get to see him that way, and we will be like him. I'll say this, no matter how much we grow as believers in this life, and you know, God wants us to grow. We talk about it every single sermon, every Sunday, every Bible school, Sunday school lesson, whatever it may be, we talk about growing in the Lord. No matter how much we grow in Christ and mature in Christ and increase in our knowledge of the Lord and Christ's likeness, or sanctified and separated unto the Lord, there is still to come an end of our salvation or a completion. There is still more to come in the next life. The finishing of our salvation is a personal completion to you and me personally, that we're going to be like the Lord. Paul said this in Philippians 3 when he talked about pressing towards the mark, right? Forgetting those things that are behind, pressing towards the mark for the prize, the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He goes on to say, not as though I have already attained. What are you talking about? What have you not attained? Aren't you saved yet? The Holy Ghost live in you? Yes. He's attained to a lot of things. He's growing in Christ. He's an apostle to the Gentiles. There's not another man like him ever lived, or that it was used by the Lord. But he says, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect. He knew there was more. There was more ahead. Perfect there means that which has reached full maturity. There's a full maturity. No matter how much we're growing in the Lord, we are to be growing in the Lord. There is a completion that is to come when we see the Lord. There is a consummation. Remember, that word was used a lot in our vacation Bible school. Consummation of all things, where Christ is all in all. A consummation and a completion of our own salvation, till we all come unto the perfect man, it says in Philippians 4. We read it last week. Till we all come, there's a finishing or a completion. It's the glorious working of God. It's the gracious working of God in our lives and in his saints. And we are to trust that what God has begun, he will finish, right? What if he doesn't really do that? What if he doesn't finish sanctifying me? What if he doesn't make me more like Jesus or complete my salvation? Well, we can be confident of this very thing. Philippians 1:6 says, that he who hath begun a good work in thee will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. The Bible promises were kept by the power of God. The best is yet to come. As glorious and heavenly and wonderful it is to know Jesus, isn't it wonderful to know Jesus right now? Aren't you so glad you know him? Yeah. Aren't you so glad that you know Jesus every day you wake up and he's with you always? As wonderful as that is, to know him, to commune with him, to worship him, to pray to him, to hear his voice, to read his word, his promises, to have the peace of God in our hearts and walk with him through this life, it's only going to get better for us. What a contrast to those that don't know the Lord. They're having all their fun now, but if they die without the Lord, they're going to die without the Lord. And it will get no better. It won't stay the same. It'll get worse, much worse. Okay? But for us that are saved in this life, as wonderful it is, as it is to know Christ, it's only going to get better for us one day. He has promised us this glorification that we're talking about, to be glorified together with Him. He has saved us unto it. He has purposed it for our lives in Christ and for Christ. Amen. Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called. Whom He called, them He also justified. Whom He justified, them He also glorified. There's a glorification He's already done in our life, but there's a glory to come. We are heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. The unbelievers around us, and there's nothing new, the unbelievers around us may scoff. Unbelievers around us may mock. The mockers will mock, and the ridiculers will ridicule such thoughts that we have about heaven and glorified bodies and Jesus coming back and walking on the streets of gold, and there's no more pain or sorrow or death, and He wipes the tears away. They laugh at that. They laugh at it as a fairy tale because they're in unbelief, an evil heart of unbelief. The mockers will mock and ridicule such thoughts that we have about our future. But our God, who cannot lie, has promised them to us. He has promised them to us. I say it all the time. I'm simple in this sense, that it's either true or it's not true. The whole thing's either true about heaven, Jesus, the cross, you know, eternal life. It's either true or it's not true. Can't halfway be true. It's either true or it's not true. These promises in the Bible that He gives us, and details that He does give us about a glorified body and rewards and streets of gold and so forth, they're either true or they're not true. And if any of it's true, I say that all of it's true. I'm not going to pick and choose which parts I believe. I believe heaven's real, but not hell. I believe heaven's real, but I don't think we'll really be streets of gold. You know, on and on, what we pick and choose what we believe. It's either true or not true. The Bible says, 1 Corinthians is quoting partially from the Old Testament, but eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared. So the things He's prepared. We haven't even seen it yet for them who didn't love Him. But God hath revealed them to us by His Spirit. Lost man doesn't have the Spirit of God. They don't see it. They don't understand it. They laugh and they ridicule and they scoff. I would too if I didn't have one born again. And the Holy Spirit saying to me, it's real. It's going to be amazing. I had not seen nor ear heard. The Spirit has revealed. I'm going to bring this to a close. I want to talk about just real quickly, like you would describe something, the who, how, what, where, when, why. I want to just hit this very quickly. Who is going to be glorified? This is our sermon, our message on glorification. Okay, who will be glorified? The redeemed of the Lord, the saints of God, those that are born again, those that have trusted them in Him in this life with their whole lives and believe this gospel of Jesus Christ. That's who is going to be glorified together with Him. How? How will this take place? I want you to look at 1 Corinthians 15. We're covering a lot today, y'all. We're covering a lot of material. Again, if nothing else, jot down the scriptures. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 35. This whole chapter deals with the gospel of salvation, by which you're saved and by which you stand, and the resurrection of the dead. That's what this whole chapter, and it's 58 verses. It talks about the resurrection of the dead. Okay? Let's pick up verse 35. 1 Corinthians 15, 35. But some men will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? So Paul's going to explain it. We don't have time to read every verse, but it's a sincere question. How is a dead man raised up? And well, what kind of body are they going to be raised up with? Verse 38. But God giveth it a body as it had pleased him, and to every seed his own body. So he's using fruit and grains and things as his example there. God gives it the body he chooses. Verse 42. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. So here's our picture, right? This body is a corruptible body. It breaks, it wears down. The hair falls out. It gets old. We get bent over in the back. It hurts when we get out of bed. We shrink. We get weaker. We get slower. It wears down. It breaks down. It is sown, it says, in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. I think this is, I just love the way the Bible just tells you. Just wish and wonder and a million different theories on this thing. It tells us there is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. How about that? We think of something being spirit as having no body. But the Bible is telling us right here, there is a natural body. We're in it. Okay? And there also is a spiritual body. It's spiritual. Let's keep reading. Verse 47. The first man, that's Adam, is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. And they're not the same. They're different. Let's keep reading. As is the earthy, so are they also that are earthy. And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. As we have borne this image of the earthy, we do right now, we shall, future, also bear the image of the heavenly. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. These bodies cannot inherit eternal life in heaven. They're not fit for it, is the best way I can think of it. They're not prepared for it. They're not made for it. Okay? Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Verse 51, behold, I show you a mystery. Here's the mystery. We shall not all sleep or die in a natural death, but we shall all be changed, all of us that are in Christ. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruption must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Even if we don't get it completely and don't understand it all, it's awesome. It is for us. It's in the future. It is going to be glorification together with Christ. Death, it will be swallowed up in victory. And the victory that Jesus won on the cross over death and hell. He is the resurrection and the life. And all that are in Christ Jesus have the same. So that's the what. Okay? That was the how. Behold, I show you a mystery. The what. We've talked about this. Glorified together, changed forever by Christ and with Christ. A glorified body like his glorious body. It's a glorious and glorified body forever, forever in this state. And we read in 1 Peter when we opened up, it's reserved in heaven for you. You who were, he's already begotten by his mercy. When will this take place? Well, according to the Bible, when he appears. When he appears. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear. I believe this consistent with the teaching of the scripture that this is the rapture of the church, not the second coming. He's going to appear in the clouds. And there's going to be the sound of the trumpet and the voice of the archangel and the shout of God. And it also says this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. We're going to be caught up to meet those Christians or saints of God that have died before. They're going to go first, just a moment first before us. And we're going to be caught up together with them and with the Lord. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Then, at the end of the tribulation, he comes back and we will be with him. We will be accompanying him. We will be following him on his white horse with the name Faithful and True written on him to destroy Antichrist and all those armies that have aligned themselves with him and to bind them and put them in the lake of fire for 1,000 years. But the rapture is his appearing, okay? His appearing, the rapture of the church. For the Lord himself shall descend in the clouds. The second coming, his feet touch down the Mount of Olives, and the mountain splits with a big divide down the middle, half to the east and half to the west, I think is how it is. But and he's going to establish, that's the day of the Lord, the Battle of Armageddon. That is his second coming. The rapture happens before that. And it is for all those that are in Christ. The dead shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain. But it is a work of the Lord. So this is when it's going to take place. So there's a completion, y'all. I'm closing, but there's a completion or a consummation to our salvation, and it's wonderful, and it's glorious. These bodies break down and decay, and the world's getting darker and darker, and we have heartaches and sorrows that are natural to this life. But the best for all of us who are in Christ, washed in his blood, is still yet to come. The best is ahead of us. I'm going to close with one scripture. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 28. And now little children, so he's writing to the church, now little children, abide in him. So what am I supposed to do? I know this is coming my way. This future, I'm to believe that, trust him. But now little children abide in him, that when he shall appear. Not if, when he shall appear. When we're still on this earth, if we happen to still be on this earth and haven't died yet, then if we haven't died before the rapture, then we're going to be part of the rapture. Living, I'm talking about living on the earth. Abide in him that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. Simply means this, live in such a way now that we're not ashamed when the Lord comes back to rapture us. We're going to rejoin us with Christ, we're going to receive glorified bodies. It's all part of our salvation that he has designed and purposed for us. But we don't want to be in the middle of looking at pornography when the Lord comes back. We don't want to be in the middle of having an argument with our spouse or complaining about how God doesn't give me what he's given brother so-and-so when the Lord comes back. We want to be thankful. We want to be living for God. We want to be working and occupying until he comes. We want to be serving the Lord when he comes till we're not ashamed at his coming. Ashamed, Lord. I'm ashamed you came right now. Should have come yesterday when I was at church. It was much better. No, we want to live for God, abide in Christ, and we live this moment, every moment he gives us, live in the current, okay? Live in this very moment as though the Lord will come in the next. Live in this moment as though the Lord will come in the next. Shall not all, he says, it will show you mystery, which shall all be changed. I thank the Lord for that. You can come. Y'all stand with me. The altar's open. I really want to encourage you to come meet with the Lord at the altar. Spend some time with the Lord, thanking God for our future, asking him to make it more real to you. The Bible says that Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. He goes, I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, that ye may be also. If it wasn't so, I would have told you. Okay? And the altars are open. Just come and worship the Lord. Thank him that the best is to come. Aren't you glad the best is behind us? We're just living on fumes and vapors of something wonderful that happened 10 years ago. We're looking forward to our future in Christ and what he has for us. And Father, we bless you this morning. Oh God, we thank you and praise you, Lord. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. We thank you, Lord, that you have condescended to men like us, people like us, to make us your sons and daughters. And it's in your heart and in your power to glorify us together with yourself. A resemblance to exalt us to full dignity and magnify us. But we're nothing. And you've chosen, Lord, to make us joint heirs with you. Oh God, we praise and we thank you that we stand fully justified in Christ, that we're being sanctified by our sanctifier, the Lord Jesus Christ. And God, you're preparing us and going to bring us into that future that you have prepared for us. Bless you, we praise you, we thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus.